welcome back. It was a very short break, so I realized that. But I think it's worth it because our two sessions here are really closely connected. I now have the pleasure to introduce actually a colleague of mine who will talk again about Mosul, but in addition also about Hawija and Raqqa, and who will focus more specifically really on the impact of the use of explosive weapons and how that continues to impact people today. As I said, Rose is a colleague of mine at PAX, where she has over a decade of experience in the humanitarian disarmament program, which she currently leads. Her main area of focus at the moment is sort of working on restricting the use of explosive weapons with wide area effects in populated areas, also known as EWIPA, of course. She's one of the co-founding members of the International Network on Explosive Weapons and has published a number of insightful reports on this topic as well. Most recently, she has co-authored with Air Wars, Laurie Treffers and Chris Woods to publish the following report, Seeing Through the Rubble, the Civilian Impact of the Use of Explosive Weapons in the Fight Against ISIS. And this report specifically studies the aftermath of fighting in Mosul, Raqqa and Hawija, and will be the main topic of conversation today. Welcome, Rose. Good to see you. Before I go to the report, again, like a few words, I think, on the session format. I will first interview Rose myself to really discuss the report. But around, I think, after 20 minutes, we will also open up the floor again to the audience. So already input your questions or save them up until that moment, and then we'll get going on that. Rose, I already mentioned the report. I've, of course, read it, and what stood out for me was that the report is first of all specifically focused on the use of explosive weapons, but at the same time there's also this focus on indirect civilian harm from the report. Could you tell me why these two areas of focus?
Yes, thank you very much, Erin, for that question. I think that with regards to the coalition against ISIS, I think most Western militaries claim that their operations have been conducted in compliance with international humanitarian law. And that they are already well equipped to limit civilian harm from explosive weapons during these operations that were fought in towns and cities, for example, by using precision munitions. However, precision has proven not to be the key determinant of civilian harm during urban combat. I mean, we've just heard from Omar about at what cost Mosul was taken. And even relatively precise explosive munitions have caused extensive harm, including in Mosul, but also in Raqqa and Hawija. Now, why did we look at the reverberating effects? I think it comes down to what Omar was also explaining, that often we only look at the numbers. When we read in the media about impact from war, it is often about the direct impact. This or that building was destroyed and this amount of people were wounded or killed. But it doesn't often speak about the indirect and more long-term civilian patterns of harm that arise from these attacks. This while we know, and we see that in conflicts all over the world, that civilian harm extends both in place as in time from the attack itself. Just to give an example, a bomb will fall anywhere within a town, may destroy a water pipe that then leaves thousands of households or people without access to clean water, which has, of course, consequences for health issues. But then not just households are affected, but the hospitals also not getting water anymore. So now they cannot wash their patients, clean their medical equipment, but also because there's no water, the heating, for example, is out of system. It's not working and the patients are in the cold. And then because the windows were already blown out from previous explosions, it is extra cold and they can only rely on stoves to heat the building. And this is not just a fictional example, by the way, it's a description of what I encountered on a field mission to a hospital near the front line in eastern Ukraine a couple of years back. But it just shows this interrelated pattern of harm and how one single strike can affect many, many people over a longer period in time. So this issue as of reverberating effects or knock-on effects, as we call it, effects on surfaces that arise from impact on infrastructure is very important to look at. It's important for the people that live in the area. It's important for organizations that want to address the needs of people. but also for military actors. They will want to prevent civilian harm out of human concerns or because they want to protect civilians, but also it's not in their interest often or in their long-term interest to level a city to the ground. They will not win hearts and minds. If they do, it will feed into propaganda by the enemy. They will make it very difficult for societies to stabilize after the conflict has ended, thereby indeed risking to prolong a very vicious circle of violence and instability. So what I would like to stress here is that many of these reverberating effects can be mitigated or avoided by not using explosive weapons with wide area effects in towns and cities, because their effects are likely to extend beyond the military target. And when this target is located in a populated area, you put civilians and civilian infrastructure at great risk. So that's why the focus for us was not only on the direct impact, but also on the more longer term impact.
And I think you already provided a very telling example of what a reverberating effect can be with your example of hospitals in Ukraine. Now, turning back to the report, could you tell us a bit more about the reverberating effects we have seen in Mosul, Hawija, and Raqqa?
Yes. Well, we just heard from Omar about Mosul, and that picture is rather grim. If you think about how long it is taken and how long it will take to rebuild the city, but also some things cannot be undone, and I think that is the most sad thing of it all. When the Battle of Mosul started, there were an estimated 1 million civilians still in the city. So, and all the parties to the conflict used explosive weapons. The coalition's weapon of choice was a 500-pound bomb, which has a legal radius over 200 meters. Iraqi forces used heavy artillery munitions, unguided rockets, mortars, Grad systems even. And of course, ISIS was using heavy mortars and improvised explosive devices. So this has led to an extremely high level of destruction. 80% of this beautiful old city was damaged. We've just seen the video images. 700,000 people were being displaced. And yes, let's think about all those faces that are behind the number of 700,000 people, all their dreams that have been scattered, all the lives that have been destroyed. And there's an estimate for the time it will take to clear the rubble that it will take over 10 years. Basic services such as water and electricity are still not sufficient to meet the needs of the population. And this makes it all difficult for people to return and go back to their normal lives and sources of income. Healthcare is heavily impacted with no adequate healthcare facilities to deal with the COVID-19 pandemic. And in Raqqa, the second case that we looked at, we see a similar pattern of harm. There's over 400,000 people that got displaced. 80% of all buildings in Raqqa were leveled. According to a local research collective, there were 8 hospitals, 29 mosques, 40 schools, 5 university buildings were hit. And there's still a lot of reconstruction needed. So water and sewage problems are still there. There's still a lot of bridges that need to be rebuilt, which of course affects economic activities. And many people still live in damaged shelters. Now, the third case we looked at in the report was a little bit different from the battles for Mosul and Raqqa, because we looked at a single attack on Hawija. This attack, I think, is well known for the Dutch audience, but I will quickly explain it here for people that are not from the Netherlands and may not be known to this incident. But on the night of the 2nd to the 3rd of June in 2015, a coalition airstrike by the Dutch targeted an ISIS munition factory in Hawija. And it was located in the industrial area, but next to the industrial area, there were residential areas too. And the results were catastrophic because the aerial attack itself was performed using relatively small explosive munitions, but then a large supply of 18,000 kilo of TNT stored in this vehicle-borne IED factory detonated. And the explosion was felt 50 kilometers away in Kirkuk. It killed at least 70 civilians. It injured hundreds of them. It damaged like 400 to 500 buildings, including, again, homes, schools, factories and shops, so sources of income. And it damaged infrastructure such as an electricity transmission station, water pipelines, roads, and the surface water sewage system. And of course, we also wanted to know what the impact was 5 years later.
Yeah, I think that really shows you how wide-ranging the implications of the use of explosive weapons with wide area effects can be. Now, what I would be interested in knowing as well, because we've heard Omar, we're now hearing you, of course, about these effects and about the impact. How do these findings from your report actually relate to official or public narratives that we hear about the coalition's fight against ISIS? It's like, what are the differences? Is this acknowledged, basically?
Well, I think the narrative is still that these states operated in accordance with IHL and that it was the most precise war ever. Yet what we see on the ground are these enormous levels of civilian harm. And these realities apparently can coexist. If we accept that IHL was implemented, which strictly, technically, I don't know because I don't have that estimation, but let's, you know, assume that it was. Then the question becomes whether IHL was implemented in a way that best protects civilians. And I don't think it was. And in general, I don't think that our expectations or ambitions should stop at implementing IHL for states. I mean, of course, we expect our militaries to not break the law. But the ambition should not be, you know, just to not break the law. It's to protect civilians. So was this the best way to protect civilians, or could we have done better? Bert Koenders was quite clear in his opening speech to this conference, by the way, that Khadija was not protecting civilians. So I think there's an area to explore for states about how to implement IHL, or basically to do their military operations in a way that better protects civilians. And avoiding explosive weapons with wide area effects in populated areas clearly is a way to do so. And there are other ways, like factoring in not only the direct, but also the indirect and reverberating effects of weapon use in military policy and planning. I think what was so striking about Khadija, we spoke, for example, with the mayor of Khadija, Mr. Subnan Al-Jabouri. It was done through email because I don't speak Arabic, so it had to be translated. Fortunately, Air Wars, with whom we co-wrote reports, does have Arabic speakers. But this information he provided was very insightful, as it provided a lot of information about the current situation also.
I think the question about IHL is certainly very interesting, and I would definitely encourage people to reflect on that, maybe also using the networking islands later on, which I will come back to, no worries about that. We're now, of course, like very much focused on this conflict and these cities' goals, but I know that you're an expert on this topic more generally. Could you say something about how reflective is what we've seen in these three cities of sort of larger or modern conflict overall?
Well, unfortunately, it's part of a bigger picture. In the last decades, the world has seen a significant trend of urbanization and of wars being increasingly fought within population centers. So big cities like Mosul and Raqqa, smaller towns such as Khadija, but also smaller towns and villages in eastern Ukraine, in Nagorno-Karabakh, etc. And we see that weapons that were designed for use in open battlefields are now being used in towns and cities, creating basically unacceptable risks to civilians. There's data collected by the British not-for-profit Action on Armed Violence. They have been looking at English language media outlets for the last decade. And it indicates that when explosive weapons are used in towns and cities, 9 out of 10 of the casualties are civilians. That's a huge percentage, and again, this is just the direct impact. So it doesn't even speak about, you know, the indirect and reverberating effects of explosion. Just direct casualties, 9 out of 10 people are civilian. I don't think that these numbers fit the notion of protection of civilians in conflict.
I think these are indeed, like you say, like 9 out of 10, those are incredible numbers. And again, emphasizing that that is just direct impact. And we've seen that impact from these weapons is actually so much more than that too. That does bring me to sort of this tension, I think, that we see. Because at the same time, of course, the coalition was there with a very clear military objective to defeat ISIS. And we all know, of course, the horrible things ISIS has done. So apparently sometimes we need to use force to protect civilians. But then if we see that this is the kind of force that we use, are we just completely in this balance between use of force and protection of civilians, completely underestimating the impact of such weapons?
It's a very difficult question, I think. I mean, Omar just explained that Mosul apparently was you know, decided to take back at any cost. I think the question always should be at what cost? And I don't want to deny that, you know, sometimes it's difficult decisions and they are being made in dynamic circumstances and pressed for time. And I personally don't think that clean wars exist. So it's like a realistic question. I think the question is what means are best suited to protect civilians. And I think in most situations, the answer will not be using wide area effect munitions in towns and cities. Sometimes it may look like a viable short-term option to gain military advantage, but on the long term, high levels of civilian harm, like besides the moral aspect and ethical aspect of this, I think the long term high levels of civilian harm, including reverberating effects, will run counter to the longer term goal of a military mission too.
Yep. Yeah, thank you. I think we're already, there's so much content here, so I think we should move in already to maybe for our part, the final questions. I know that as part of PAX, you're also involved in this process to work towards an international declaration to protect civilians against the use of AVIPA. Could you tell us a little bit about that process, and if we achieve the declaration, how will that actually change people's lives on the ground?
Yes. So AVIPA refers to explosive weapons in populated areas, and PAX is part of this international network of organizations around the world that have witnessed this harm from explosive weapons in populated areas over and over again. By now, over 100 states, as well as United Nations agencies and the ICRC, have publicly recognized the civilian harm caused by explosive weapons in towns and cities. And this failure to protect civilians from this particular practice has been repeatedly raised also by successive United Nations Secretaries General, who have repeatedly called upon all parties to conflict to avoid using explosive weapons with wide area effects in populated areas. Several international meetings have taken place already to discuss how an international political commitment could be developed to prevent this harm. Ireland has led a series of consultations in Geneva last year, and actually last March we were supposed to have the final negotiations on the political declaration text and then have a signing conference in May. Unfortunately, those two meetings were cancelled because of the COVID-19 pandemic. So the expectations are that the final negotiations will be resumed as soon as the restrictions from the pandemic will allow for a face-to-face meeting again. So hopefully this spring, it's to be seen. States, of course, don't need to wait until that moment. They can start implementing military policies and practices to the effect of the declaration without the declaration being there yet.
Yeah, I think that's a great question. And I think for my final question, you already sort of tied into that, because once we have that declaration, and let's hope negotiations can soon be resumed, is that enough, or do we need something else besides a declaration? Like, what additional steps would be needed to actually change things for people?
Well, this is a very good question. I mean, obviously, the political declaration is a piece of paper, and it's a paper that will show political will and commitment to change a practice, which, you know, creates a very distinct pattern of civilian harm. But yeah, the implementation of that political declaration into military operational policies and procedures will be key to a change that will be, you know, felt on the ground. So states will need to gather and make available relevant data and need to share adjustments to policies on a national level, share good practices on the impact or a good practice on how to mitigate the impact of explosive weapons, but also to better address the needs of the affected communities. I think there's a lot of research out there by organizations such as PAX and other members within the INU network, but also by OCHA, ICRC, the Geneva International Center on Humanitarian Demining, and others on technical characteristics of explosive weapons, about good policy, military policies. And there's a lot of research out there that shows the humanitarian impact on displacement, education, healthcare, development, basic services, and about how these impacts are interrelated. And in my view, the best way to deal with those effects and this clear and distinctive practice is not using explosive weapons with wide area effects in populated areas. And states have the opportunity now to deal with this distinct pattern of harm by joining the political process towards a political declaration, and by also, by doing that, building a community of practice where good examples can be shared, data can be shared on the impacts, including on reverberating effects, and contributing to a general shift away from this practice.
Yeah, from thank you, Rose. From where I'm sitting, it's a very convincing call to arms. I see a lot of movement in the audience section, so very glad that people are participating so actively. With regard to your final remark, I see a very interesting question by Anna de Courcy-Wheeler. She says, Rose, you mentioned good practices. Are there any good examples of military policy out there with regard to AVIPA that you could share with us? Maybe a positive note for a change.
Yep. No, that's a very good question. We have seen examples of how some militaries have already put in place policies in specific operational contexts that to limit the civilian impact of explosive weapons. ISAF, for example, in response to the increasing civilian casualties resulting from their operations, they have introduced tactical directives to ensure more effective protection of civilians by including restrictions on air-to-ground and indirect fire, only allowing this when there was no other option to protect own forces. But also the African Union mission in Somalia, AMISOM, in response to mounting concerns over civilian casualties as a result from indirect fire, that it was also recognizing that it was undermining AMISOM's operational success. They introduced a new and a more restrictive indirect fire policy. So I think these are examples that we know of, and there probably are much more examples, which it would be good if states would share these amongst each other. But it's these kind of restrictions that on an operational level that we see fit for better protection. And yeah, this was also done, by the way, after Hawija, there were, you know, there were changes to the targeting policy to have more scrutiny in these kind of aerial attacks. So I think there are positive examples, and other directives and tactical guidance will be suitable for different operational contexts, I think.
Yeah, I think it's encouraging to hear about these examples. Just for the few people who may not know, ISAF was the NATO mission in Afghanistan, just as a side note. I see more questions, one by Hannah, which is more about the method of your research. She thanks you for your presentation, and she asks you, what were the challenges you faced in doing research on the reverberating effects 5 years on in Hawija?
Thank you for that question. I mean, normally if I would conduct this kind of research, I would want to go to the area and speak to people. This was, of course, not possible for a range of reasons, including security concerns, but also COVID-19. So this time we had to do the research from behind our desk. Fortunately, we had 6 local sources that responded to our questions. And we were very honored to, of course, also have the mayor of Hawija. And the sources that we interviewed sometimes wanted to remain anonymous, which is, I think, related to either their operational security or personal security. So I think we gained a lot of information. The challenge, I think, for me personally was the inability to travel there and have face-to-face interviews with people. But having said that, I think we were able to sketch a rather a good first picture of the situation on the ground 5 years after the attack, where the area was still a pile of rubble and still the estimates are that only 40% of the buildings have been rebuilt in the area. Many children are still afraid for planes when they hear them. There's a lot of people with psychological trauma. There's still no sufficient electricity or water services. Factories and shops that were in the area are still not open, so still people have no source of income, which of course and indeed will impact the dignity of people, of families, of their communities. So the picture after 5 years was not good.
Yeah. I think it's very important that at least we did the research 5 years on. We don't always see that. I hope the audience will allow me for some shameless self-promotion. Of course, there's the report we can refer to. But I think also the interview with the mayor you mentioned is on the PAX website and can really recommend reading that as well. I think, Ghost, we could have made this an hour-long session because I see so many questions from the audience. I want to move into the very final question, which I think also is an interesting one about policy. Neil Wilson is asking us, you mentioned we should be more ambitious than simply not breaking the law. Is it feasible to convince policymakers of this, and how could we do that?
I think that should be. Of course, that should be possible. I think also because, for example, the ICRC is very much supportive of this political process on explosive weapons, and I don't think it's a secret that IHL will, you know, allow for different interpretations. And I think that, but again, I don't think we should change international humanitarian law because it will not dictate, you know, how specific weapons should be used in certain contexts. I think we should, the answer to our problem is much more on the operational policy and practices level. Yep. Where the changes should be about, which is also why we are supporting the political declaration, because we don't feel that the international humanitarian law, those rules are quite clear. And the ICRC, for example, is also quite clear in that they say that when you use these explosive weapons with wide area effects in populated areas, it is very likely that you cannot act in according to IHL, because it's difficult to make a distinction between combatants and non-combatants. But yeah, I don't think that's a very difficult point to sell. And I think also because states are, some states are really committed to protection of civilians, it's much more sometimes, I think, about connecting the dots and also creating opportunities, practical opportunities for states to put these commitments to protection of civilians into practice, for example, by this political process.
Yes. Thank you, Rose. I think in the meantime, we'll be putting up a poll. That was the end of the Q&A. Thank you so much for being here and for this very insightful discussion into reverberating effects from explosive weapons use. For people that don't see the poll yet, if you're in full screen mode, you may have to exit that mode so that you can see the poll on your right. And the poll is as follows. After listening to Omar and Rose, my understanding of civilian harm has broadened. It hasn't changed, or the presented definition of civilian harm is actually more expansive than I think it should be. So please take your time to answer that poll. We will unfortunately not have really not have time here to reflect on the outcomes of the poll, which leads me to the following point, namely that we have networking islands. We know that's difficult to have a conference in these times, so we very much encourage people to make use of virtual networking opportunities. If you go to the home page of our platform and you scroll all the way down, you will see a link to the networking islands. And we hope, since so many of you have contributed so actively, that you will find your way there and continue this very important conversation. I think for now we have a 2-hour break from the program, and then we'll back with some, a 3-hour break, if I'm not mistaken, sorry about that. And then we'll back with some more academic discussion on how we can actually model reverberating effects of civilian harm. Thank you very much.